So welcome everyone, thank you for joining us. We're very honored to have tonight's speaker with us here. He is recognized as one of North America's leading clinical herbalists and has been an active practitioner and teacher for over 40 years. He holds a Bachelor's of Science in Environmental Biology, a PhD in Health Sciences, and has authored over 12 books and is the founder of the Wild Rose College of Natural Healing. So without further ado, please help me in welcoming Dr. Terry Hillard.
I've decided to design this differently. Even though we had a slide presentation set up for working with the liver, I know that, which I've been doing as a dog and pony show all across North America, every time I come here, there's way more questions than most of the places. So I decided to have it a little bit closer to what I'm going to call a fireside chat. So instead of lecturing for an hour and then leaving 15 minutes to ask questions at the end, I'd like you to interrupt me whenever you want to ask questions so we can understand more detailed. You don't have to wait for a while to get an answer. The topic I was tasked to talk about today was cleansing, but most specifically, the liver. So I'm gonna talk about the liver and cleansing in general over a period of time and see where we go on a magical mystery tour and look at that. Does anyone know why I would choose liver?
Lots of toxins build up in the liver?
Yeah, there's no question that toxins build up in the liver. And so even though a lot of people think that cleansing has to do with the digestive tract, au contraire, the center of all cleansing has to do with the liver. Yes, I've had products on the market for years that cleanse the whole body. And some of them make you poop, therefore people think it's just, if you poop, you're cleansing. But all cleansing really comes down to how you can metabolize things around the liver, for sure. That's part of the reason. But there's even a more specific reason why we would do it now, today, at this time.
Spring is the season of liver.
That's right. That's right.
The element wood.
Exactly. So from a Chinese point of view, you're totally right, or should I say an Asian point of view, on the five element theory, we're in the time of the liver. So we can do more cleansing on the liver in the next month, month and a half, than we can the whole rest of the year put together. This also means all kinds of other things directly related to that. The best time of the year to work on a guy's prostate is for the next 2.5 months. When I was in clinical practice for over 40 years, I'm retired now in clinical practice, I could get more done on men's prostate problems in April, May, and June than I could the whole rest of the year. Obviously, it's more economical if they hit it this time of year than it is the whole rest of the year. I would have some guys that need a little bit of a tune-up in old November or whatever the case may be. We hit hard in April, May, and June, and on the coast here, you almost want to move it back to late March, April, May, and June. In Calgary, we almost had to move it forward. We start in July, just kidding. It's not quite that bad, but it is pretty bad. I got a Facebook thing the other day from some of my friends in Alberta, as a lot of you know, I grew up there and had my clinic there for many years. I really feel sorry for those people on the West Coast. There's ponds of snow all around. I really feel sorry for those people on the West Coast having to deal with all that green grass and flowers and all that stuff. And you get to ski and be with snow. So, you know, different strokes for different folks, what can you say? We all have our troubles. But as we're going through the springtime, we can deal with the liver the most. But there are several other corollary things like the prostate. Why would the prostate be actually functioning the best at this time of year? The reason is that the acupuncture meridians for the liver go right straight to the prostate. So again, the prostate is kind of stimulated by that time of year, the element of wood. By being stimulated by that, that's why we can get more done at this time. Now, to be honest with you, it had been noticed for about 20 years before anyone could figure out why we can do more in the spring for the prostate. It wasn't until we actually checked with other theories and other people to realize that's what time. At the same time, if a woman's going through menopausal issues, they start coming up at this time of life. It's a logical thing because it's getting warmer, you're going to have more menopausal problems. But that's not the real answer. The real answer is that it's because it's the spring and the activation of that whole system again. Because almost all menopausal problems, even though you might think that they have to do with female hormones, they don't. What do you think they have to do with? That's right. That's what we're talking about. So it should be there. That's the answer. Because really it's the liver clearing hormones. So let's just take that as a little bit of a case study onto itself. Now, what I'm going to say is an analogy. It's not exactly physiologically what happens, but it's close enough what's physiologically happening. The analogy works. So during a whole reproductive stage of a woman's life, she's making hormones. Obviously, she's making hormones the whole time, but she's very productively working on hormones for pregnancy and menstrual cycles, especially when she's not pregnant, but even a little bit when she's pregnant. During that whole period of time, she'll go through a cycle, and 25% of the blood in each heartbeat goes to the liver in a resting adult. Let's put that and put it aside, because that's an important aspect to know on this whole thing. Seems like I'm having a little bit of a problem here tonight. That is probably going to be good. And so during that whole period of time, the woman is actually demetabolizing her hormones on a regular basis. The reason for this is you wouldn't want to have gridlock in the blood system with hormones. It'd be kind of like permanent PMS. That'd be a drag, right? So 25% of the blood's going through there, and we demetabolize proteins, or demetabolize the hormones on a regular basis. So it goes around. So theoretically, after four cycles, it would demetabolize all the hormones on the purpose that you're going to produce more if you need to, and that's how we'll be able to keep the hormone flow properly. But that's not exactly what's happening. During that whole period of time, a certain percentage, and nobody's really quantified exactly how much it is, and one of the reasons it's different from person to person, they're time depositing little bits of hormones. And where are they putting them? They're putting them in side saddles. They're putting them in their bones. They're putting them in their bust line. These are where you're time depositing hormones over the period of time. So if I used to have a protocol that I used for many years for cellulite. It was a great protocol for getting rid of cellulite until we realized this protocol was great for getting rid of cellulite, but it was increasing the probability of osteoporosis in women. Because what it was doing was it was stopping the female hormones from producing side saddles, or whatever the case may be. So what happens when a woman starts going through menopause, they give you the impression that they just turn off the tap and there's no hormones anymore. Not the case. The case here is that when a woman stops producing hormones from their ovaries, they're actually starting to release, a time release, the hormones they put in their cellulite or their side saddles, et cetera, et cetera. Got the idea? So this is actually to chelate the calcium and work along those lines so a woman doesn't go through osteoporosis as much. So a woman who has bigger hips will hardly ever get osteoporosis if they time deposit it. The thing is, these hormones are not exactly the same as the original hormones. They're a stronger type. I like to consider them kind of like the feisty redhead. So these ones are a lot stronger because they're time capsuled, and so when they come out and go into the bloodstream, the liver knows it has to demetabolize female hormones, and it comes along, but it doesn't recognize the hormones, so its old tricks of trying to demetabolize doesn't work. So what it comes down to, it doesn't know what to work with this feisty redhead, so it throws in the fire and burns it, aka hot flashes. So the hot flashes that are going to happen in menopausal time or many other things are really to do with the adjustment of how the liver works. You got the general idea? So now we've got both male issues and female issues that don't seem like they have anything to do with liver going through that. Of course. At this point in time, we live in probably the most polluted time in the history of man that we know of. Our body has very good detoxification system. Some detractors against natural healing says, I don't know why these people are going to the health food stores and wasting all their money doing cleanses and stuff like that. It's just complete bull. Our body will cleanse itself. Of course it does. If it didn't, we would have died out a million years ago or so. We have to be clean in our body. But because we're in the most toxic time in the history of our planet, we have to give it a little bit of help to be able to assist it along the ways to be able to do that. Again, the organ for that is liver. The liver is the great detoxifier, the great cleanser. But it didn't start then. It started a long time ago. I don't know if you remember how good your memory is, but if you remember back, I mean way back, I mean way, way back, around 650 million years ago, we were all hanging out as one-celled organisms. And we've been doing that for about 400 million years or so. And all of a sudden, one of the people, probably a guy, I don't know, but he decided that, you know, it'd be kind of cool to hook up. We don't need to be single-celled organisms anymore. Why don't we become multi-celled organisms? Create a commune. Let's get together and hang out. And then we started becoming multi-celled organisms. Up to that point, every single cell had a liver. It's called the endoplasmic reticulum. So when we started building this up in our body and become multi-celled organisms, certain parts of our body decided to take the job over and process the toxins. So in mammals' cases, and most higher vertebrates, it's the liver. So it's a harmonic of the liver, but every cell in the body goes through the same detoxification process.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
I'm a type 1 diabetic. I'm an insulin dependent diabetic. Does the pancreas not also process toxins?
Not really.
What does the pancreas do?
The pancreas does all kinds of things. Of course, certainly it works with sugar metabolism, insulin, and stuff like that. That's part of it. And the other part of it is produce digestive enzymes. So it has two basic functions.
So is my pancreas as a type 1 diabetic, is it dead inside my body?
No.
What is it doing right now?
Again, I haven't examined you, so I don't know exactly what yours is doing. But typically a type 1 diabetic is kind of like unemployment insurance. It's kind of not enough to live, so it needs some supplements. It needs, and that's why a person
would
take
insulin.
Well,
it's not producing insulin anymore, period.
Period?
Right.
Okay.
So, as an insulin-dependent diabetic, so what I'm asking is, if it's not producing insulin, what is my pancreas doing?
Okay. So,
if it's not,
I'm gonna answer your question specifically and broaden it out a little bit. Most type 1 diabetics are still producing a little bit of insulin. You might not be producing any. I don't know that. Okay. And therefore, you'd have to be taking a fair amount of insulin. But lots of times, what it is just a raising of the level, so a person has to take so many units of MDH or whatever the case may be, to be able to raise it up. But that is only about a 10% function of the pancreas. It's doing all kinds of other jobs too, but not cleansing toxins. So, to come around to what I think your question is asking, because you have a compromised pancreas, can you still clean up toxins? Absolutely. The liver is doing most of that. In some mammals, the pancreas and the liver are kind of really connected, and they're almost the same thing. In fact, it's a kind of a combination of our spleen and the liver. So for example, a bear has really two livers, and that's replacing the pancreas and the spleen in them. And so when you dissect a bear, they would have the two livers. Not the case in mammal, or sorry, not the case with humans. We fine-tuned it down a little. Does that kind of answer your question?
Yeah.
So you're still processing and going through the toxins, and there would be a little bit of feedback loop because of the compromisation of your pancreas, but almost for sure your pancreas is not dead. It's compromised. How severely it's compromised is, well, depending on how much insulin you have to take, etc. So what I'm trying to do is broaden the scope out here to give you the idea that the liver does a whole bunch. But probably the most important thing that I can say with the word liver is the root of the word is live. in almost every language. So when we're looking at from at least a physical metabolic function, that's what lipase is. I remember back in the early 70s when I was doing my undergraduate and one of my physiology professors asked for 2 points on an exam, what is the function of the liver? I was pretty sure I already passed and I wrote back. There's over 400, or there's over 500 functions of the liver, so I think it's absurd for 2 points for you to ask me what those functions are. He gave me the 2 points. The point is, it does so much that we could spend the rest of the month just discussing the liver. But there's an old axiom in natural healing. If you don't know, treat the liver. Because if you cleanse the body and treat the liver, almost the body will take care of itself and almost everything else fixes itself. It's that simple. You can do all kinds of fancy high-tech supplements and high-tech methods, but if you can get the liver working properly and the digestive tract functioning properly, you're probably going to get the body to readjust itself. So, no, we're not trying to replace detoxification like some physiologists think we're trying to do. No, we're not trying to do it for the body. We're trying to assist the body. Therefore, we try to do it quite a bit in spring. An awful lot of people ask me, when's the best time to cleanse the body? And the simple answer is, whenever you have a chance to do it. If you can fit the 12 to 15 days in, whatever kind of cleanse you're going to do, if you can fit it in, fit it in. But the best of the best of the best is in the spring, because the liver acupuncture really is functioning right now. Now that'll clean up all kinds of acne and psoriasis, it'll clean up all kinds of hormonal issues, it'll clear up all kinds of inflammation, of course the liver itself, but it can work on arthritis, it can work on all kinds of autoimmune diseases, and male problems, etc., etc. So you can get an awful lot done. So concentrate on the liver. Not a bad idea. So the liver, again, 25% of the blood in every heartbeat is going through the liver. But it comes from two sources. It's just like in the Old Testament, the joining of the two rivers going in there. 50% of the blood, approximately, that's going into there is coming from the digestive tract. So almost everything that comes into our body goes to the liver. In this role, I like to think of the liver as the great shipper receiver. Things come in, it looks at it and says, oh, I need some of that stuff over in sector 443, and sends it over. Oh, I can change that into something we're going to need later. Oh, I can store that. So virtually everything that comes into our digestive tract gets cleared, vetted as you might want to say, through the liver, and it decides what to do with it. Burn it, detoxify it, conjugate it, reduce it, oxidize it, reduction. Those are the four processes it'll go through in that. So it's a decider to a large degree. On the other side of that, the other rest of the blood's coming through there is our systemic blood, and that's what's dealing with the hormones. That's what's dealing with whatever chemistry we produce in our cell. That might have to do with the microbiota in our digestive tract. It might have to do with toxins that are created inside of our body, because even though we're taking in toxins, if our digestive tract's not working properly, we're going to create toxins inside the cell. And so we have to be able to work on both of these sides to be able to get everything flowing.